Welcome to this presentation. We will speak about, I will speak about Mesos and Kubernetes and Swarm. That will not really be a fight. Don't expect too many details about this orchestrator during this talk, because obviously 1 hour, we won't have time to go into the details. The idea is to give you an overview of what you can do with this orchestrator, and maybe give you some tips on how to choose one if you need to choose. So my name is Christophe Furmaniac. Obviously, you have noticed that I have a very nice French accent. I work for Zenica, which is a French company, but which has an agency here in Singapore. And yes, I'm not very good at writing slides, so just for the warm-up, who uses Docker or containers on a daily basis in the assembly? Okay. Who uses Docker in production? Okay, two, yes. Who has already played with an orchestration tool? Okay, so you don't use Docker, but you use an orchestrator, okay. Or maybe you are using Rockit or something else. So, next one, with running an orchestrator in production? Oh, yes, one. So, which one are you using? Okay. Good. So, first, before going into the details of what this orchestrator can provide you, let's see how you have to deal with Docker without an orchestrator. So, for example, how do you launch your containers? I will speak mostly about Docker, but it works with other container technologies. So, if you just use a Docker command line, I hope it's not for running Docker in production, because that's not really, that's dirty. If you use a custom shell scripts, maybe you want to use to write your own orchestrator written and based on a shell script. That may not be a good idea. Maybe you are using a tool which provides a nicer UI, like or at least a nicer command line interface like Ansible, and that's a good point, because you are in the good on the good way to immutable infrastructure as code. That was for running containers. What about network? Because if you are only launching Docker for containers that don't have network interaction, that may not be as interesting as it seems. So when you have to run Docker, when you want to expose ports, you have two ways to do that. Either you can use auto mapping in Docker. When you are launching using the command line, you are using dash uppercase P, or you are manually binding ports on your host to Docker, to your containers. So, for example, if you had to launch two Redis containers on the same host, you would have to assign manually two distinct mapped ports. That's not very nice. And maybe in this case, you will have to use a tool dedicated to service discovery, like a console or etcd. Another question, when you are running containers without an orchestrator, how do you schedule container on your host? How do you choose which container to run on which host? How do you deal with failures, whether it is related to your container or to your services, which rely on several containers? And how do you deal with the failure of a node? How do you scale up and down? How do you deal with host maintenance? Because you know you have to, sometimes you have to apply patches to the operating system, or to you have to upgrade the Docker version. This is already complicated, but how do you do when you have complex apps, especially in the nowadays with microservices hype and cloud native application, and how do you update your application? I forgot to ask a question. Who is a developer? Mainly a developer? Who is an ops? Nobody. Oh, see.
Yes, one, two.
Two. So if you don't use an orchestrator, you will have to collaborate really, really hard with your ops if you want everything to run smoothly. So maybe it's time to move to use an orchestrator, because by design, orchestrators will allow you to schedule and place your containers without thinking about it. Orchestrator will deal with the failover of containers, nodes, and cluster management. Will deal with load balancing. They will provide the service discovery. Most of them provide what we call overlay networks, which are networks that are spanning across all your hosts. Another important thing after networks is storage, because sometimes you still have to use some persistent storage, and I think personally that's the next big challenge with Docker and other containers. Technologies. How do you deal with secrets? Because obviously you don't want to expose your login and password, the login and password of your databases publicly. You don't want to store it in Git repository and so on. So how do you deal with that? Orchestrators will provide. Most of them will provide auto scaling capabilities, which means they can detect that your application need more containers, for example, because you are looking at the CPU consumptions or the memory. If you want to automate everything, orchestrator will have to provide CLI and or REST API. The other mandatory part of infrastructure as code is deployment configuration as code. It means you don't have to go through user interfaces to be able to configure everything. And in real life, you will need RBAC, because you RBAC for role-based access control, because I don't think that you want everybody in your company to be able to start, stop, and destroy any services. So that's the promises of orchestrators. Orchestrators, yes, but which one? Because there are loads of orchestrators. We will speak about the first three, Kubernetes, Swarm, and Mesos, Marathon, and DCOS. I will come back on that later. But there are other one, Rancher, which is an orchestrator that I like very much. Nomad from HashiCorp, the folks that are building console and so on. Netflix has its own orchestrator, which is called Titus, which is based on Mesos and that uses a customized framework. Maybe you've heard also about Deis, which is the same kind of Heroku experience, but relying on Kubernetes. You have also Mantle, which is using Mesos and Marathon, and that may use in the future Kubernetes. There is OpenShift, which is the Kubernetes distribution built by Red Hat, and other ones, Container and Confoundry. So, when you may have to face a choice how to choose your orchestrator. Obviously, for me, it's really important that it must match both your ops and dev expectations. You are not working for yourself only. You are all part of the success of the delivery of the product. So it must be a choice made by both ops and devs. It will allow you to support modern software or development strategies like continuous deployment, canary builds, and blue-green deployments, for example. And also, obviously, the ops part, it will allow you to support modern operation strategies, everything related to the new way to operate such platforms. I will come back on that just after. So who should choose, and already gave you the answer. Both container-related strategies are useful for both for developers and ops, so obviously both developer and ops have to make the choice, and it's really important for me. I'm a really fan and of the DevOps culture, and in the DevOps culture there is what we call the CALMS. The C is for culture, and the S is for sharing. It's really, really important to share the choice and to share your expectation to be able to make the right choice. But you also have to know that there will be impacts on both devs and all ops folks. So what can be the impacts of op folks? Let's turn that into an advantage. It's a new way. It's a new exciting way to work, because it really changes the way your ops will operate platforms. Less pet nodes, by maybe you know the paradigm cattle versus pet. Pet is the idea that you have nodes that you give them names, you give them specific capabilities. With orchestrators, you won't have such nodes. You will have only cattle, which means host with CPU and RAMs and so on. They will be part of the cluster, and you don't want to know, you should not have to know on which node your container are running. So more cattle, obviously, which will lead you to more infrastructure as code. This will allow you to more easily add nodes to your clusters. So, like I said, new procedures and tools, because the network and the storage management will not be the same inside an orchestrator and outside of an orchestrator. New way to deal with metrics and logs management, and new way to do monitoring. So now, the dev part, obviously also a new exciting way to work. New notions to use maybe in your application regarding, for example, service discovery. And like I said previously, especially in the context of microservices and cloud native application, as a developer, you will need to be more concerned about metrics, because orchestrators heavily rely on metrics to be able to autoscale. So obviously you will need to code what is needed to provide metrics to your orchestrator. Also, you will be more concerned about everything related to LSEC, because LSEC is a really important thing in orchestrator to be able to know if your application, your containers are running as expected or not. And also you will be more concerned about logs, because orchestrators will allow you to spawn more containers, so more logs, so obviously you won't be able to go on the nodes, on the host nodes, and have a look at the logs of containers by containers. So you will have to use tools such as the Elasticsearch stack or Greylock, for example, or Splunk if you have money to spend. Another question really important when you are a developer and you want to use an orchestrator is, can I use it on my dev box? Because the one important thing to have in mind is, ideally you should have the same workflow of development and testing for your application, whether you are running on your dev box or on any other environment. So let's start with Docker Swarm. Docker Swarm, and especially what's called the Swarm mode, that is a native orchestration shipped with Docker since version 1.12. This is a replacement of the standalone Swarm. This is sold by Docker as all-in, no external dependency. Actually, that was a big move from Docker when introducing the Swarm mode, they say the only thing that you need is the Docker binary. Everything, the Docker binary and packages, everything is included. You don't have to run other software like etcd, for example. Trivial setup, that's a nice feature when you want to test it by yourself on your dev box, for example. I don't encourage you to set it up manually on your production platform. And another cool thing is that it's secure by default, because everything is every nodes on your Swarm cluster are speaking to each other in a secure way. What are the ways to install Docker Swarm? There is also the manual official setup, which is using the Docker command line. You can also install Docker Swarm if you are using the Azure platform, thanks to what is called Azure Container Services, which is unlike Amazon ECS, it's a functionality inside Azure when you can choose which orchestrator to use. And all the demos that I will be running in the talk will be based on Azure Container Services. You can also use Rancher to start a Swarm container. I will come back on that later. Or you can use Ansible roles or Terraform recipes to install it. What are the main features? So it's a declarative service model. That's a fact for all the orchestrator, which means that you declare the state you want your application to be, and the orchestrator will do everything needed to match your expectation. You can do the placement with labels and constraints, which means you can say, I don't want this container to run on the same host as this one, or I want this container to run on this specific host because this one is connected to internet and the other one are not. There is an overlay network bundled with Docker Swarm, and this is the way to provide isolation between your application. There is a service discovery facility that is relying on the DNS. Load balancing is there. You can do rolling upgrades. The persistent storage part is relying on the Docker storage drivers, and there is also a secret facility, which means you store the secret once, and they are available across all your nodes. Just before a quick demo of Swarm, the application that I will deploy during the demo, it's the same application that I will deploy on Swarm, Mesos, and Kubernetes. It's a Docker Coin application, which is provided by Jérôme Petazzoni, which is one of the main contributors of Docker. This is a good example because it's a typical microservices-based application, because you have services which is called RNG, which is running, I think, Python. There is a worker that is developed in Ruby. Asher using I don't remember the language, and the web UI is running Node.js. So that's a nice example. So the demo, crossing fingers. So I have a Docker Swarm cluster, Docker stack, services. Okay, I can check that my cluster is running as expected because I already deployed a stack in it. If I'm too quick at changing screen, don't hesitate to stop me. So that's just a simple application that allows me to check that everything is working. Okay. What does the application look like in when I want to run it in Swarm? I suppose that everybody running Docker know how to use Docker Compose. Docker Swarm since the last version can rely directly on Docker Compose descriptors, you have to be running the latest version, which is version 3 of Docker Compose reference syntax. So you see here I have all my my services, the services RNG, which is using, I'm declaring which image it should use. You can see that it is a particular descriptor information that says this service has to run, is a global one, which means it has to run on all the nodes of my cluster. Okay. Here, another service, which is Asher 1, I say I want only one replica, which means one instance of the container all over the cluster. The web UI, the same one, with the particularity here of a port exposed, which means I can contact the service on the port 80 of on any host of my Swarm cluster. Then I have a Redis backend and a worker here with four replica. So how does it work? My Docker stack create-c Docker Kunz. Non, c'est diplôme. Long keyword. Obviously, when you start to switch between orchestrators, you start forgetting what are the good command lines. So here, it is deploying all the. First, it is creating the network because the network is a common point between all my services, and then it is launching all the services. I can stack. Services coins. So this command allow you to see all the services launched in the cluster. You can see the RNG one, which is in global mode, and I have three replicas because I have three nodes. The web UI is the Asher, a single instance here, I can see, and the worker, I have four instances spread across my three hosts. I can service PS, for example, so I want to see where are the containers. I can see here that I have to check. So I can see that I have four instances. What is the URL to check that everything is working as expected? So UI is very simple. It's just a UI showing the. Yes, it's working. It's showing the rate of Docker coins that are produced. So get used to this UI. You will see it. Three times. So if I can see this graphs, believe me, it means it's working. Well, thank you, Jama. So, okay, where's my talk? Yes. So it was okay for Swarm. Let's speak now about DCOS. I tend to use. Alternatively, Mesos or Marathon or DCOS. Actually, DCOS is a top product. It's a englobing product. DCOS means data center operating system. Mesosphere is a company that built a commercial product around Mesos and Marathon and so on. They build also the DCOS orchestrator that is relying on Mesos, which is a data center, a task scheduler that can run containers, but also other type of workloads. Then you have frameworks that are speaking with Mesos. For example, there is Marathon, which is the one used inside DCOS for application. Application means long-running application. And there is another framework called Metronome that is used for jobs which are more short-lived or at least not infinite life application. And but you have other one like Aurora or Kronos or and so on. So how do you install DCOS? So there is a command line provided with DCOS to set up a cluster. You can also install not DCOS, but Mesos and Marathon thanks to Rancher, which is another orchestrator. So for the moment with Rancher, you can install both Swarm and Mesos. DCOS is also provided as an orchestrator option by Azure Container Services, and obviously you can also install it using Ansible and Terraform recipes. A quick overview of the features of DCOS. To be noticed is that failure resiliency is not provided by Mesos, which is just a task scheduler, but by the frameworks that are relying on Mesos. It means if you schedule tasks by yourself on Mesos, Mesos is not able to detect that the task is not running anymore, so you have to use Marathon on Metronome or Metronome to check that everything is running. There are several ways to provide service discovery. For example, you can use virtual IPs thanks to a sub-product called Minuteman. You can also rely on a Mesos DNS, which is a DNS updated in real time by Mesos every time a service is created. You can also use another product, which is called Marathon LB. It's okay, I already have one. Thank you, Jean. You can perform rolling upgrades and blue-green deployments also. The persistent storage is present, but limited regarding to what Swarm can provide, because you have two kinds of persistent storage. The first one is called the local persistent storage, which is actually a persistent storage which is bound to a node. It means that your container will always have to run on the same node, so that's not really the full idea of a persistent storage. You will not be able to move your container from a node to another one when you will be using the local persistent volume. And the other solution is to use what are called external volumes, for example NFS partitions and so on. But they will not be managed by DCOS itself. To be noticed regarding the persistent storage, both the local persistent and the external volumes capabilities does not allow you to scale. It means you will only be able to have a single service, a single instance of a service using a storage, which is not the case with other storage drivers in Swarm, for example. There is a notion of pods. I will come back on pods later, which it has been introduced by Kubernetes. The notion of the type of workload of a pod is a set of containers that have to be collocated. For example, you want to maybe you are using data volumes to store configuration of your application. You want your data volumes to be, which are actually containers, collocated with the containers that are running using the configuration. So you want the container to always be created side by side on the same host. Okay, so that's the notion of pod. So it was not present at the beginning in Mesos and Marathon. It is present since Mesos 1.1.0 and so on. So a quick demo. So that's what Mesos look like. Not Mesos, sorry, DCOS. So you have a dashboard. So you may notice that with DCOS you have a user interface. That was not the case with Swarm. I will come back on that later. You can see the list of resources that you are that are available to you. For example, I have 25% of my CPU use, and so on. I can see the service that are running. Here I just have a load balancer services and a tool container that is running. A nice feature of DCOS is that you can install pre-packaged application. So you have community packages. For example, it's easy, really easy to install a Kafka or GitLab or Spark or Jenkins or, for example, Artifactory and so on. And obviously, you can package your application in the same way, store the definition in a Git repository, add it in your DCOS installation as a new source, and you will be able to install application with this system. So this was DCOS. Here we have the marathon part, which is the part that will launch application. I can see the same kind of information, and I also have Mesos One. I can't remember. I just want to show it to show it to you, because it's really not. This is really less sexy than marathon and so on. Okay, so the demo. I will deploy exactly the same application. I can see that. Can chat. For example, for the moment. There are only three marathon applications started. Where am I? I will start them and show you what the descriptor looks like. So what a descriptor looks like, for example, it's not relying on Docker Compose, not this one. It's a JSON file. I think you can use a YAML, but I'm not sure. You will find here all the information regarding the container. You can see that I'm using the same image, and I did not configure it in Swarm, but it's also feasible. I configure here L-check to, that is a way that to provide to Marathon, to that is how you can provide to Marathon the way to check that your container is running as expected. I can check that everything is running in Marathon. Everything is running. You can see, for example, here the Azure is there are three running instances. I will go on for the demo. Okay. And finally, the web UI. Just check that everything is running. So here you can see the web UI is still deploying. It's okay. So now I can go to this awesome user interface, and it's working. Nice. So same application in that previously, but in Mesos. And it's still working. So the gods of the demo are with me. Oh, forget about that. Next, Kubernetes. This is a software that allows you to group containers that make an application into logical units. That's an orchestrator like the other ones. It is built upon 15 years of running production workload at Google. This is not the software that is run by Google, but it is the same kind of algorithms that they are using just to be noticed. Google and Red Hat are the two main contributors of Kubernetes. So lots of developers behind this. How to install Kubernetes, which is also sometimes abbreviated as K8S. KubeADM is a command line that allows you to set up a cluster, which is provided when you install Kubernetes. There are some commercial distribution like Aprenda, Kismatic, which is the commercial distribution of Aprenda. There is also Tectonic, Tectonic, which is a commercial version of provided by CoreOS. But you can install a cluster with Tectonic if you have less than 10 nodes, it's still free. Still, you can use Azure Container Service, and you can also use Rancher to install Kubernetes. Like I said previously, there is a very nice distribution of Kubernetes, which is called OpenShift, OpenShift is relying on Kubernetes, but the user interface is not the same. And also, you can use Ansible and Terraform. One of the main features of Kubernetes is pods. Like I said previously, it's a way to group containers when you need to. Obviously, you still have service discovery, load balancing. You can process rolling updates and blue-green deployments. There is a really nice feature regarding storage. I find that very smart. It's a good way to collaborate between ops and developers, because actually ops will provide pre-allocate persistent volume. That is a functionality called in Kubernetes. And then users, developers, will be able to make claims for persistent volumes. So the idea is that your ops will pre-provision storage blocks, and you will be able to use them, and you don't have to configure anything. You just have to say, I want to use a storage volume. There are two other very useful functionalities, what are called daemon sets, which is the same kind of functionality as the global mode in Swarm. It's a way to say, I want that one instance and only one of this container runs, or these pods runs on all the nodes that have this flag. So it's a way to, for example, to start logging facilities and centralization or metrics and so on. And there is also a recent feature called stateful pet set. That was called pet set, and that is now called stateful, which is, I won't go into the details, but it's sometimes difficult when you want to start programs that are software, like, for example, Cassandra or Consul, that need when you launch several instances of the containers, they need to be able to connect between each other. With Swarm, you will have to use port binding with Kubernetes. All the containers inside the stateful set will be able to know their IP address and so on. So it's really, really useful. There is also a nice feature called the config map, which is a way to store configuration once and only once in the cluster, and it's available for all the containers that are requesting it. So it's a way to store, an alternative way to store configuration to environment variable, for example. And then you can also store secrets. So like for Swarm, you can store secrets once in the cluster, and they are available everywhere. The demo. So I already have, there is also a nice UI for Kubernetes. Yeah, I can see I should have to, yes. The way Kubernetes make the isolation is through what's called namespaces. So there is a kube system, namespace that is dedicated to everything that is administration related. For example, I can go inside it. Oh, no. Let's do this one. Sorry. And see the pods. I can see. You can see in the UI that you have access to metrics. the CPU and memory consumption, everything is centralized by a product called Hipster, and Hipster is one of the pods, the containers, the application deployed inside the Kube system. There is also a default namespace, and I already created a web counter that is the same application that I showed you previously in a Swarm demo. So let's go. Demo cavities. Let's use this. So here I'm initiating a namespace called Docker coins. And then I will start my my Redis pod, my RNG, which is I will show you which is a daemon set, then a hasher. I will check that everything is okay. I can use, so there is a command line get pods that allow you to see everything what are running. Here, all my pods are running. I specified two replica for the hasher, single one for the Redis, and the RNG, like I said, is a daemon set, which means you one instance and only one on all the nodes of the cluster. And I can see that they are running. So now I can create the worker. And we'll have to wait for the to access to the web interface, because I'm running Kubernetes inside as a Azure Container Service, and the way Kubernetes is run inside Azure Container Services is through a close integration between Kubernetes and the platform, which means when I ask Kubernetes to expose an application, in this case a web UI, through a load balancer, actually it will create an IP on the Azure platform dynamically. So I have to wait for the application to be to be started. So what does it look like? For example, let's see the RNG. Here you can see this is everything is stored as a YAML. I can see here this the RNG is specified as a daemon set. I did not specify a replica, the number of replica. If I go for the hasher, I think I said two. Here I have you find the image, the Docker image that is used by the pod, and here you can find the number of replica that I requested. Yes, so now it's okay. Because I'm lazy, I will go. I have to refresh first. Then I can go to my Docker coins. I can see all the pods in my Docker coins. I can go to the service and see that this one is. So with the IP, and it's still working. Nice. So let's get back to the demo. So wrap up, because I did not provide you hints in order to choose which orchestrator will fit the best your workload or your context. So it's really, regarding Swarm, it's really interesting because there are no dependencies. You only need to install Docker. That's really a good choice for simple web and stateless application. I would not recommend it for complicated and large-scale application for the moment. Remember that Swarm mode only exists since version 1.12, so it's not really old yet compared to the two other ones. There is no pod support inside the Swarm, so it means you can collocate containers if you need to. There is no role-based access control. There is no user interface. You have to pay the commercial version of Docker, which is called Docker Data Center, if you want to have a UI on top of Swarm. And there is no specific multi-data center support. Of course, not everyone needs a multi-data center, but I think it's important to notice it. Regarding the developer experience, what is really nice when Docker with Docker Swarm is the fact that you can use Docker Compose out of the box. So you will be able to run Docker Compose on your laptop, and you will be able to run quite exactly using the same configuration almost on production. And it's really, really easy to set up a local Swarm instance. You just have to launch a single command, a Docker Swarm init, and you will have a Swarm instance with a single master and single nodes, but it's really easy to use it. Regarding DCOS, really important, it also works for non-containerized applications. When I showed you the packages and the what's called the universe, most of them were not run as a containers. And for example, you can install a full Hadoop cluster using a single command line thanks to DCOS. This is really, really interesting. So if you want to build an application that relies on big data, for example, you can develop your application and deploy them using Docker Docker services, and you can install inside the same cluster Hadoop and Kafka and Spark and so on. So really, really interesting. There are a lot of available packages. So, like I said, nice for a mixed app. This has been tested by companies like Twitter, for example, with tens of thousand nodes. One of the problems is that there are lots of UIs. Like I showed you, there is a DCOS one, there is a Marathon one, and so on. Mesos DCOS has a support for multi-data center. The open source versions has a support for authentication. The drawbacks is that you will need more stacks to assemble and to debug, because you will have to run DCOS, Mesos Marathon, and Marathon LB, load balancer, and Mesos DNS, and so on. So sometimes it can be complicated to debug. Load balancing between services can be really complicated. Actually, there are several ways to load balance services, and that's not really easy. The feature to create an overlay network is still a little bit tricky. And for example, I did not use an overlay network for my demonstration. I used Marathon LB, load balancer only. There is a limited support for persistent volumes, and you will have to pay for the DCOS commercial version if you want to use authorization. So authentication is provided by default, but authorization, you will have to pay. Focus on the developer. You will have to use a native application deployment descriptor, like I showed you, JSON and so on. There is a way to run Docker Compose inside Mesos cluster thanks to what's called a Docker Compose executor. I never tried it, but I provided you in the slides a link to a video on YouTube where you can see how it works. And I encourage you to have a look at this one if you're interested. If you want to run Mesos on your local laptop, you can. There is a project called Mini Mesos, but it's really it's more a project that has been created to test the development of Mesos frameworks, not to test application inside your Marathon. So it is a limited capabilities. Okay. What disturbed me the first time I used the Mesos is that you have to specify limits in terms of memory and CPU every time. Even when you are testing on your laptop, you have to specify how many CPUs and how many memory your application will consume. That's not the fact with, for example, Swarm and Kubernetes. But on a second thought, actually, it's a good thing because it forces you to think about that as the beginning, at the beginning of your development process. So that's a good thing. Regarding Kubernetes, so this is a more feature-rich and mature product. There is I really like the pod workload definition, and I encourage you to have a deeper look on the pod workload definition. So the support of stateful pets, stateful sets is really really interesting. There is strong support from Google and Red Hat. It has been tested with 1,000 nodes. There is a user interface and a command line. You can provide airbag support thanks to namespaces, and there is a capability to create multi data center clusters thanks to something called federation. On the drawback side, it's more complex because actually, if you have a deeper look on what is installed, you will see that there is an etcd server. There are components called API server scheduler, kubelet, kubeproxy. So the first time you will want to have a look at how it is working underneath, it can be more tricky. There is no network overlay provided by default, but compared to a DCOS installation, is really, really easy. And there are several technologies that you can use. For example, I think for Mesos, the one that is put into the front is Calico, but you can install Flannel, Calico, and so on, and other ones for Kubernetes. One of the drawbacks maybe is that you don't have a direct interaction with the Docker daemon. Focus on dev, so still native application deployment descriptor. You can have a bit of a Docker Compose support thanks to a project called Compose, starting with a K, that can translate a Docker Compose file into Kubernetes descriptors. There is a packaging application called Helm that was developed by Deis, and since maybe 1 or 2 months, Deis has been bought by Microsoft, so strong support of Helm. And yesterday was announced a new product called Draft, which is relying on top of on Helm, also developed by Microsoft. There is also some side project like KSonnet or Istio, which are really that has been developed around Kubernetes to ease the usage of Kubernetes. You can test locally Kubernetes thanks to a product called Minikube, and you can, if you want, try the OpenShift version. You can also use Minishift. Just to finish, what I call meta orchestration, because maybe you noticed, but no, later. So you can install, if you want, Kubernetes inside a Mesos cluster. You can also install Swarm inside a Mesos cluster. So you can use Mesos and DCOS to run your EV workload like Hadoop, Spark, and so on. And if you prefer Swarm for containers, you can use, for example, Swarm in Mesos. And like you probably noticed, you can install Mesos and Kubernetes and Swarm inside a Rancher cluster. So that's really nice. So the slide with the pointers. So everything that I spoke about during the talk. And that's it for me.